Stand up and worship. Praise God. Glad you're here. Ready to enjoy the presence of the Lord. I told him, Frank, if you weren't in front tonight, I was going to call you up here. I've been missing you up here with your arms spread out worshiping. And glad to see everybody. Glad to see my family tonight. Glad that the Lord has let you have another day of life and another day to serve Him. And we're just going to press into some things tonight. First, worship, and then we've got just a few minutes of business meeting, and then we will go right into the armor of the Lord. So I'm excited to preach tonight for a little bit. But let's not waste any time. I say that a lot, but we're kind of limited in our time. So we want to make the most out of our worship and the Word. And so use these altars. Use this time to get towards God, get closer to Him, and know that He is here. He is for you and He's not against you. Father, thank you for being for us. We thank that your Holy Spirit does a great work in us, Lord, if we will allow you to. So, Lord, we just want to say right now, Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. We're going to sing about that, Lord, and we're going to open our hearts and our lives to let you do what you want to do. Have your way, have freedom in this place that we might experience you in a special way, and that the atmosphere might be changed in a way that's pleasing to you, that glorifies your Father, and that brings your kingdom to this earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing together.
the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the your glory.
overcome. Just let him have his way in our lives. Not to fight against him. Pretend we're something we're not. And facades and face masks and putting on the front, it's not good for anything. God knows who we are. He knows our hearts. He knows what we deal with. He knows our issues. And if we'd truly not play church anymore and use the altar for a place of repentance and confession, actually be honest with God, he would do something in this room that none of us would be able to do on our own. And that's what you get the opportunity to do. So we sing a song that says, oh, come to the altar. Don't waste your time anymore trying to do it yourself or do it your way to make yourself better, any of those things. Take off the face mask. Come down before God, exactly the person who you are, and let him make you something different. Let's change the atmosphere of the church by first changing us. Amen. God, do a work in me, Lord. Look, I can't change my neighbor, but I can change me. Lord, do a work in me.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Is there any man in the room that would come pray over these men right here? Don't let these men pray alone tonight.
Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing alleluia. Christ is risen. Bow down before him. to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Let's sing that again. Oh, what a Savior. Sing it out, church.
Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ has risen. With the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Bear your cross as you wait for your crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
His name is Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we thought were dead, breathing in life. Have found their hope. The orphans now have a home. All that was lost has found its place in you.
This is for you, church. You
lift our weight.
We make a song.
song. Jesus, we love you. Sing it out. Oh, how we love you. Our affection, our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. We love you. Come on, church. Oh, how we love you. Our affection, our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion poured out on the feet of Jesus. We love you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you for helping us, God. And thank you for letting us love someone so lovable and easy to love. Even though we are hard to love, God, you are easy to love because you've always done what was right and good and perfect towards us with our best interest in mind and with heaven in the view. God, I thank you, Jesus, for all that you're doing in this room, God, for the ones who want you to, the ones who won't let you, and the ones that are fully surrendered, God. Break down all walls and all barriers that we might fully be everything you've called us to be for the kingdom's sake, for the sake of this community and this church. In Jesus' name, show us your glory. Amen. Let's give him some praise. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. You can be seated. As you're seated, remember When you leave, offering buckets are always in the back or in the front. We're not going to pass them anymore, so just do that. You're doing a good job at giving, and we thank the Lord for that. Let's get Miss Ashley up here, and as she dismisses you, and then after that quick business meeting, we'll be ready for the Word of God.
Okay, we'll try again. Sorry, guys. We're going to dismiss the youngest group of school age kids, which is preschool, kindergarten, and first grade with Miss Tiffany Greer. So if you're going into preschool or kindergarten or first grade, you can go with Miss Tiffany. And then nursery, which is two and under in diapers, is Miss Monica. You can take your nursery kids and preschool, first grade, preschool through first grade. Junior high boys, let's go ahead and dismiss you out this side door with Brother Toby. Junior high boys. And then we have a new toddler class, which is 2, 3, and 4 year olds. Miss Jordan Brown is in the 4 year. So that's the toddler class, preschool, no, sorry, under preschool. That's 2-year-old, 3-year-old, and 4-year-old. Toddlers. Junior high girls can go with Miss Maddie. Junior high girls out the side door with Miss Maddie. 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. Yeah, girl. And then 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th are in the back with Miss Lacey and Miss Cindy. And then that should just leave high school boys and girls with Brother Patrick and Brother Derek.
Amen. Let's go ahead and open with the word of prayer. And then Linda, if somebody would get Linda the handheld, there we go. Thank you, Miss Ashley, if you get that. And we'll get started with our business meeting in the minutes. Father, we thank you tonight. We thank you for your business, God. Help us be good stewards of all that you've given us, that we might glorify your name in this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's give our new members a hand clap for joining us. Amen. Yeah. Yeah, we're thankful, so thankful. Ephesians chapter 6. We're thankful for all God's doing, all God's saving. Thankful for the Hope Center guys. So thankful for all of you. You don't know how much life you've brought into our church and the ability to do ministry. We're not a church that wants to sit around and just have church. We want to be able to minister to you and your families and love you and give you a chance to do something different. And most of us were in your position at one time. Most of the people in this room were in your position. And by the grace of God, we're not anymore. And by the grace of God, you're not going to be anymore. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank the Lord. Yeah. Ephesians chapter 6, stand firm. Last week we preached about where your strength comes from. I wanted to remind you of two books that I've been mentioning here lately. The Christian in Complete Armor. This is volume 1 by William Gurnall. This is 3 volumes of just this, what we're preaching on. It's not an easy read, but it is worthwhile. You can read a half a page and just chew on it, okay? You don't need to read much at a time. It'll mess your head up. So get this. This is one of the, if you look at Spurgeon, Wilkerson, look at who said it's a good book, okay? And this is when you look. This is the other one I'm reading as I preach through Sunday, Revival God's Way by Leonard Ravenhill. You got to read Leonard Ravenhill, one of the greatest revivalists of our day and age. And he will set your soul on fire and your tail on fire. He will light you up and he will not apologize. And I need to be lit up most of the time. So I thank the Lord for these good books, along with the best-selling book of all time. Amen? Amen. The Word of God, that's the most important thing. Let's read some verses here. Verse number 10 through verse 13. A final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you'll be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Father, help us to preach your word tonight. God, it's been a big day in your kingdom. Lord, you're wanting to do more. God, we want to let you. God, we don't want to get in your way. We want you to just have your way. And God, we give you glory for it. God, we honor you in this place. As God, we are not. We thank you, Father, for your word and what it means to us tonight, God. And we want to live by it. We want to be empowered by it. We want to be like you, so help us to see you in all the scriptures. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I believe some of the issues with our spiritual battle is twofold. It says, number one, to put on the armor of God, or put on all of God's armor. So twofold things I see here in the beginning. Number one, the reason we have a lot of issues is this: we are not prepared. And number two, we don't know our enemy. That's the two biggest reasons why we lose spiritual warfare. Because, as I'll get to in a minute, you're not supposed to lose. You're always supposed to win. I mean, that you will stand, that you are going to stand firm, that after the battle's over, you will still be standing. That's the goal. So the issue we have is this: we don't put on all the armor of God, and we don't know who we're going to fight against. We don't understand the strategies of Satan. We don't see him for who he is and see what's going on before us. Now, he said in verse 10, and I like a final word, you know, put on the power of God, be strong, mighty power. And then he says in verse 11, put on the armor. So you put on power, and then you put on all. That's what you need to circle that in your scripture. If you circle or line or underline all of God's armor. This is, and we're not going to get into what the armor is tonight because I want this to last longer than 1 week. Amen. I want it to be deeper than a shallow mud puddle. I want it to go somewhere. I want us to be really equipped when we get done with this to fight a real battle, not just, oh, put on the armor. Okay, that's what it is, and move on. I want us to really flesh this out. Now, we talk about what this armor looks like, and we're going to in the weeks ahead. But tonight, we're going to see what it will do and who we are fighting against and what we are fighting against. Verse 11, if you put on all of God's armor, I love this statement, you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. You will. So that's what you gotta get in your mind first. I need to go into every battle with a winning mentality. You've got to set yourself up to win. Even if I'm not better than you in basketball, when we get there, I'm going to tell myself, I'm fixing to beat them. And you might beat me, but I'm going to tell myself when I get there, I'm going to beat you. Because I got to have a winning attitude. I got to understand, I am a winner. Like in this battle, I'm the winner, Satan's the loser. God's the victor, I'm victorious through him. He wants me, God wants me to win, amen? God wants me to stand tall. God wants me to stand strong. God wants me to have victory. God does not want me to fail. God does not like me to learn through failures. He wants me to get it right. We're all like, well, we're just hard-headed and we just learn through failures. It's because we chose to not learn a different way. Like, we could learn a different way. Like, God has a plan and a purpose for everything. I get it. And God can redeem everything. But wouldn't it be nice if God didn't have to redeem something in our life because we did it right the first time? You know, we're always claiming that God can redeem anything. Well, why don't we just do it right so he doesn't have to? Like, take the power of God, use the power of God, put on the armor of God. And if you put on all of God's armor, you will be able to stand. The word able here is dunami. What it means is it's possible. It's possible to stand. It's not impossible. Whatever's coming against you in the spiritual realm, it's possible for you to have victory. You got to, and I know, listen, like, oh, he's preaching the power of positive thinking. No, I'm not. I'm preaching the power of positive scripture. I mean, this is what the Bible says. So I'm not trying to tell you if you're big enough in your mind you can conquer anything. I'm talking about if you're doing what God wants you to do, then victory is yours. So we got to think correctly. We got to walk correctly. It's possible. You can. You could. You may. You might. And it's going to be possible if it is of power. Verse number 11 says it in a positive way. It says, if you put on all the armor of God, you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. There's a positive and a negative way to explain things. This is the negative way to say it. The reason you can't stand against the strategies of the devil is because you're not putting on all the armor of God. I need to know that. There's a reason. I just can't figure out why I keep going back to this same spot. I just can't figure out why I can't give up. I can't figure out why I can't. And it's literally because you're not doing what the Word of God says. Put on all the armor, and there's no place for Satan to get his claws in. Because you're covered. You're making sure that you're everything. He is your everything, and that your everything is covering all that you are, that you might be everything for the one who has given you everything. Now, this is a spiritual battle with spiritual weapons where you take a spiritual stand against evil spirits. You got to think about it that way. A spiritual battle with spiritual weapons where you take a spiritual stand against evil spirits. You can stand. You can stand. You're not a loser. You're not weak. Listen to me. You're a child of God. Greater is he. If you know the word of God, you claim the word of God. I don't, like my dad says, I'm a this, or my mom said, well, that's great, but that's not going to help when the devil's beating you over the head with something, what your mom and dad said. Like the Word of God says, greater is he that is in me than he that's in the world. The power of God in me is stronger than the power of Satan around me. I'm claiming the Word of God, and I'm standing again. I'm standing firm. God wants you to stand. You say, well, how do you know he wants me to stand? Well, he said in verse 11, so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategy of the devil. He said it in verse number 13, therefore put on every piece of God's armor that you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will be standing firm. Verse 14, stand your ground. Stand your ground. Put up a fight. I just don't know. I don't know why I'm going through this. Because you won't stand up. I know I keep giving it. Because you won't stand up. You'll stand up to your wife. You'll stand up to your husband. You'll stand up to everybody else. But you won't stand up to the devil. Like you got an attitude with everybody else in life. But you won't get one with Satan. He comes into your life, you let him run over you, but you'll run over everybody else in your life. That's not how this works. At some point, you're going to have to get mad at the one who's causing you these issues and stand up. You ever had to stand up for yourself? I mean, I have. When I was in seventh grade and I was 5'3 and husky. Y'all never wore no husky jeans, did you? Not a brand, it's a size. They did make husky too, huskies. But like you had to stand up for yourself. You had to stand up for yourself. You finally had to take ownership. I've caused these issues. I've allowed Satan to run my life for too long. I've bowed to the wrong God. It's not me. It's not him. It is him. I've got to now stand up. I got to be a man of God. I got to be a woman of God. I got to quit being run over by the things of the world. Now, God wants me to stand. God wants me to be victorious. And if you want to stand firm, and if you want, and I think that's a lot of the issue, the want to, you want victory, but you don't want to fight. It's kind of the welfare mentality of the world we live in. I want something for nothing. Well, let me tell you something. In the real world, people don't get something for nothing. We work hard for what we get. We work hard to put food on the table. We work hard to put clothes on our back and send our kids to school and pay for our stuff. We work hard to do that. The labor of our hands. Well, God's called you to work, hear me, extremely hard at being what God wants you to be. It's going to take some work. And I know a lot of people are adverse to work. You just want God to wave his magic fairy wand over you. I'm serious. You want God just to, God, would you just make it all better? God, would you just take all this away so I don't have to deal with this anymore? I mean, God, I know you can do this. And God's saying, I know I can too, but I want you to do something. Like God's already given you positional righteousness in Jesus Christ. You're seated at the right hand of the Father. But he wants you to practice some righteousness while you're here too. Positionally seated at the right hand of the Father, then practicing the practical righteousness that he gives you in everyday life. Now listen to me. You got to know who you're fighting and what you're fighting and what's going on and what you're coming against. Because the devil has some strategies, verse number 11. He has a plan. He's not as dumb as you make him out to be. In fact, if anybody was dumb, it'd probably be on our ends because he has no new tricks and he keeps on tricking us. I mean, literally, he does the same thing since he's done ever since the garden. Is that really what God says? Are you sure God doesn't want you to just be happy? Really, he said you can't do that? I mean, really, you know, God just loves you, and he don't care how you act. He just loves you, and you know, he's a snake. That's why you don't like snakes. you know what I'm saying? Because it reminds you he's subtle, he's hiding, he's waiting, he's lurking, and at the moment you walk up and you don't see him is when he strikes. He's got a strategy. He's played this game before. You're not his first victim and you won't be his last. Amen? Because he knows what he's doing. I mean, he's a war general. Like literally, he's been waging war since the beginning of time. Tried to do it in heaven and God kicked him out. And when God kicked him out, he set up shop on earth to make sure that we didn't make it to heaven. Verse number 11, the strategies. We can't be exposed or be naked at any point in our life from the armor of God, or Satan will use that spot as his place to get you to fall. Your weak spot. And remember this about God's armor. God made the armor. God formed the armor. God provided the armor. God has proved the armor. You just got to put it on. God knows what you need. God knows what fits you. God ain't asking you, David, to go put on Saul's armor. God's asking you to put on his armor. And it's not, look, it's not going to be too big. It's not going to be too small. The sword's not going to be too heavy. Like, his burdens are not like that, is what the scripture teaches. His yoke is what you need to be in. And he's form-fitting. God knows what Satan's going to do. Amen? You need to give some credit to God. Quit acting like he don't know what's going on. He knows it all from the beginning to the end. And he sees it all. And he's forming for you a set of armor. And he's got it for you. Like, it's in the Word of God. We're going to learn about it. And he has made it so it will fit you perfectly. And that if you use what he gives you, that he made, that he formed, that he proved, that he provides. And you just got it. It just seems too easy. He just wants me to put it on. There's got to be something. Are you telling me God provides everything I need for life and godliness and I just got to receive it? That's exactly what I'm telling you. It's exactly what I'm telling you. God gives you everything you need for life and godliness and you just got to receive it. You've been trying to whittle your own sword for years and God already had one made for you. You've been trying to forge your own helmet or write your own word. You've been trying to do this on your own for years. And God's saying, well, I'm watching you. God's laughing. God's having a good day. He'll figure it out. She'll figure it out at some point. I've got it all right here for you if you want it. You're just going to have to decide if you want it or if you don't. I love this book that I'm reading. It says, Satan with all his wit and wiles. He will never defeat a soul armed with true grace. Nor will the contest ever end in a stalemate. Look into the Word. You will not find a faithful servant sifted and winnowed by his enemy who did not come off with an honorable victory. Witness David, Job, Peter, and Paul, who were the hardest put to any upon record. And lest some should attribute their victory to their own inherent strength, the glory of the victories is attributable. To God alone, in whom the weak are as strong as the strongest. There are two reasons why the Christian who seems to be overmatched is yet unconquerable. Number one, the curse always lies on Satan. You're not the cursed, you're the blessed. The curse comes against him. Like, he's cursed, not you. You're blessed. You're a child of God. And number two, God's always placed limits upon Satan. Satan can only be allowed to do in your life what God allows him to do. So God's already proven, how can you have sure victory? Because number one, Satan's already doomed and cursed. And number two, God puts limits. You know, he doesn't allow, even in the scripture said, that the time of the God's coming back would be turned back for even the sake of the elect because they couldn't handle what was going on and God would come get them. God would come rescue them to get them out of the torment that Satan was putting them through on the earth. There's nothing else that will ever work to defeat Satan's strategies except for the armor God provides. This trickery, the sly, slithering, subtle attributes of this snake, how do we fight it? Now, who are we fighting? Verse number 12. Think about this. I don't have time. I wrote more, but I can't go. Look, we got kids everywhere, and we got things we gotta. Here's what I'd rather do. I'd rather not go too far, and you wishing I'd stopped early. I'd rather leave a little meat on the bone, and you want to chew on it and come back next week. All right? That way, I wish you would. Well, stay tuned. All right? Come back next week. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, and this is where we'll start next week, but against evil rulers and authorities of unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places. I got as much wrote down for that as I did for the first half, and we can't do that. So fight. Don't give up. Fight. Be armed. Study your scripture. Stay in prayer. Stay in fellowship. Worship. Trust the Lord. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. Father, help us to fight this week. The good fight. Be good soldiers in your army. God, help us to understand who we're fighting against. That the enemy that we think that is in front of us is not always the enemy. And that you're going to reveal some things to us through this week and next week about who we're really fighting. God, we bless you that we're not fighting with you anymore, God. We're not fighting you. We're fighting for you and not against you. We thank you for that. We ask you to continue to bless this room. Bless my Hope Center friends, God, that they will continue to fight the good fight, Lord. Push them, God. Help them to see victory is ahead of them, Lord. If they'll not give in, God, I thank you that the promise of the scripture is those who do not give up in well-doing will reap in due time, Lord. Don't let them get weary and faint, God, because in due time they're going to reap something good. We praise you for that, God, and we thank you for everyone in this room. Maybe there's someone here tonight, Lord, that's been serving you many years, and they're doing everything they're supposed to do, God, but I pray the same prayer for them, God. In due season they'll reap if they don't faint, God. Help nobody to faint, Lord, but help us be strong, hands to the plow, until you return. Thank you for everyone in this room, most of all for your Holy Spirit who makes a difference. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Go get your kids.